This is the air I breathe. I love you. I'm desperate for you. What a notion. Have you ever considered something you've been desperate for? Got to have. Willing to do. Desperation is a strong word. Yeah, strong word. Desperation means you throw caution to the wind. You forget about form or fashion. You're not worried about form. Think about you. How they act, because I'm desperate. You better be careful of a desperate man. Because he'll do anything for you. You better hope you got somebody in your life who's desperate for you. That means they'll love past the hell in you. Because they're desperate. Desperate for you. That means they'll do anything for it to be all right. You ought to pray for somebody desperate in your life. He was desperate for us. Willing to do anything. Anybody ever walk up to you and ask you to do something? And they say, you say, what you want me to do? And they tell you. And you say, no, I can't do that. I can't do that. Because when you weigh it in the balance, whatever benefit you're supposed to get, what you're offering is too much. And apparently that was a conversation in heaven. When God met, God being plural, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, my granddad used to call it, there was a holy conference. When they met it, and they said, we need to send somebody. Apparently Jesus raised his hand and said, I'll go. He didn't think it, the scripture says, robbery to set aside his divinity and come down and be us, who he created. Why? Because he was desperate. He was desperate for us. Jack, all he wants us to do is love him. Don't think of love in the sense that you've experienced only. Because some of you have had your love definition tainted. Some people have given you an inappropriate picture of what love is. Love I'm talking about he has for us is perfect. It doesn't cast shadows. It has no shade. It's love for love's sake. It's love regardless of what you can do in return. It's that kind of love. Why? That's desperate love. He said, I'm desperate, so desperate that I'll die for you. Scripture says, scarcely will a righteous man die for a friend, let alone somebody who hates him. But if you're desperate, baby, you'll die for free. You got me messed up, T. Y'all done brought this song. This supposed to be the after sermon song. You can't have me up here. I can't even talk my way out of it. I'm sitting up here working on plan A. You done. I think y'all understand. I'm in worship too. It's worship for me too. Now. You got a preacher that don't worship. Watch out. I used to know the preacher. I'm going to come right down, right before the sermon, and then No. I want to be in it. Yeah, pour it all over me. Let me feel what's going on in the good and the bad. Man, guide me. Oh, thy grace. Start of the sermon series a week or so ago, titled Journey to the Cross. Journey to the Cross. And we started out talking about the pathway that Jesus Christ took to get to the cross. And I want you to know that it wasn't a straight line. No, he came to do what he was to do, but there was intrigue and politics. There was betrayal, treachery. All of these things happened to Jesus on his way to the cross. He was going to happen. But as we study scripture and see the events unfold, it gives you a fuller picture of what was going on with our Savior. I want today to talk to you about journey. I told you I didn't even really have 2 minutes. Titles for this is Journey to the Cross Part 1, Journey to the Cross Part 2. So this is Part 2. If you have to have a subtitle or subcontext for it, then let's call this one The Great Pretender. The Great Pretender. Or another way of putting it, and this is why I say it's full of intrigue, and the preacher who betrayed Jesus. The preacher who betrayed Jesus. If you scroll through the Gospels at different places, you will find all of them dovetailing on this week leading up to Jesus' crucifixion. Matthew and Mark write it differently, but they all get to the same place saying it's as if there is a holy magnet that compels them to reach this point. They tell it from their own vantage point, what they remember, but they all seem to shall remember similarities. And all of them start talking about the pivotal point that turned the tide against Jesus was when he raised Lazarus from the dead. That was the straw that broke the camel's back. Know this. The religious establishment couldn't have somebody running around who could actually raise somebody from the dead. That was crucial. That made them impotent. Nothing you can put on the table after that that makes me pay attention to what you got to say. Sunday morning Bible study don't seem as important when this dude over here raising folk from the dead. And so they knew that they were in trouble, and that's why I say there was intrigue. He got to go. They said, he got to go. We can't have him undermining. See, you think of the temple at that time of this as this holy place, and to be sure that was the structure, but behind the scene folk were making money. Folk had position and power, and the structure was in place, and you had to obey the power structure, and if you messed that up, then you were messing up all of our well-being. And here comes Jesus with his simple self. Don't want no money. Don't care about clothes. And got the nerve to raise somebody from the dead. How in the world are we going to compete with him? And after he raises Lazarus from the dead, he makes his way with his disciples to Jerusalem. And the people have heard, it's been, as they say in literature, noised about that Jesus is coming. And there's murmuring, he's coming. Somebody says, shh, be quiet. Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. Shh, be quiet. Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. Yeah. And so he gets there. And it's amazing how the people respond to him. Spontaneously, things start happening. People start taking off their clothes and throwing them down in the road and picking up palm fronds. It's not an organized protest. No. You know, sometimes they happen spontaneously. Sometimes the protest is just organic. And sometimes somebody says, I'm going to sit at that counter. They're going to feed me. It wasn't planned. Sometimes the woman said, I'm going to sit down on this seat on the bus, and I ain't going to get it. It ain't planned. It's just organic. And so they throw down their cloaks, and he comes, riding in on a foal, a coat, a baby coat that had never been ridden before. And they start saying, Hosanna, Hosanna. Now, you'd think everybody in the crowd would be saying it, considering this man just showed he has a mastery of life and death. But there's a whole group of shade throwers. Religious folk got their arms crossed, lips tooted up, mad, talking out the side of their mouth, talking about, look at him. Who do you think he is? The king? Hosanna? Oh, yeah, they're not happy with what's going on. And if you go and study the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, you'll find, Cam, at a certain point, all of them get to a place where they say there was one in his group who wasn't happy. He was disappointed. Let me read what Mark says, because I think Mark makes it very clear. He said, and Judas Iscariot, which simply means Judas from Carryoff, one of the 12, that's important, one of the 12, went unto the chief priest, wasn't called, didn't nobody text him, didn't have no appointment, went looking for them, showed up, hey, you got a minute. And Mark wrote, to betray him unto them. And when they heard it, they were glad and promised to give him money. And he sought how he might conveniently betray him, my Lord. He wanted convenience in treachery. No inconvenient treachery wanted here. I wanted to be comfortable when I'm dogging out the Savior of the world. Sought how he might betray him. Two verses, Matthew chapter 14, verses 10 and verse 11. To make it a little bit clearer, Matthew puts a little bit more flavor in it in chapter 26 at verse 15. He puts a little more detail in it. And he said unto them, look now, because you want this in it, what will you give me? And I will deliver him unto you. In other words, what's in it for me? What you got for me? Because clearly he's not enough for me. And they covenanted with him, made an agreement with him for 30 pieces of silver. 30 pieces of silver. Judas. Don't name your child Judas. That ain't cute. And the stigma that goes along with naming your child Judas is nothing but negativity. Judas is without a doubt the most notorious, vilified of all the disciples. Look at this from a teaching standpoint. His name appears last in all the lists of the disciples, which shows his significance. Can't avoid the fact that he was a disciple, but they put his name last. And that's if they put it in there at all. In Acts 1, his name doesn't appear at all in the list of disciples. But to be sure, you can't avoid the fact that Judas was one of Jesus' disciples. And this is a significant point in our lesson today. He was a part of the inner circle of Jesus Christ. Every time, though, he's mentioned in Bible, the Word of God reminds us that he is a traitor. Can I tell you something? If you want to be known when you leave here, make sure you have some part in writing your own story. Because if somebody else writes the story, they're going to write what they think about you. And Matthew, Mark, and John had nothing nice to say about Judas Iscariot. Every time, now, this is St. John, who was bold enough to call himself the beloved disciple. He made sure that he cast nothing but shade over Judas every time he wrote his name, and that's because Judas was not in charge of his own press. He forfeited that right when he betrayed not only Jesus now, he also betrayed the entire disciple posse. Messed them all up, made them all look bad. Dr. John MacArthur reminds us that Judas and his life give us two basic truths that I want you to remember. First, you need to know this. It's possible to be near Jesus and to associate with him closely and still be full of sin. It's possible. He also tells us that Judas is a clear reminder that the purposes of God stand sure. No matter what anyone may do, they can never thwart God's plan. No matter what they do. So let's look at this great pretender today. First of all, in order to understand why Judas would have done what he did, you got to look into his personality. We don't know a whole lot about him. He's only mentioned about 20 times in Scripture, twice in the book of Acts. He only speaks two times. From a scriptural standpoint, he is an enigma, a mystery. Not a whole lot about him, but there are a couple of things we can glean from what is in Scripture about this man and his life. First, his name is Judas, which ironically is the Greek rendering of the Old Testament word Judah. Judah was the son of Jacob, and he was the son of Jacob, who was the father of the largest and most dominant tribe in Israel. So Judah, by his very name, stands as living proof that having a godly heritage is not enough to save your soul. Or you can come from a good church-fearing family and still be the toe-up one in the family. And just because mama may have and papa may have, God's only going to bless the child that's got his own relationship with him. Yeah, don't matter how many times mama get her Sunday school ticket punched. She can't leave that to you as having a relationship with the Lord. Know this, individually, you must have a conscious turning away from sin, and you have to personally embrace the gospel message. It doesn't matter what your folks have done. There has to be a life-changing, soul-saving encounter with Jesus Christ. But let's look at where he comes from. His name was Iscariot, man of Kerioth. Kerioth was a humble farming town right outside of Jerusalem, about 23 miles outside of Jerusalem. Can I talk to you about this for a second? He came from a farming community. He ended up in the big city. No doubt he could have been the prodigal who was tired of farming with his daddy, decided I need to get up out of here and go and find me a better way. And no doubt he thought New York, big city of dreams. No doubt he went there looking for a better way because he was tired of feeding sheep and doing all of those things. So I'm destined for greater things. And so he makes his way to the big city and somewhat makes a name for himself such that he gets noticed by this man named Jesus. Don't ever doubt that he snuck into Jesus' circle. That didn't happen. There was no sneaking. He was intentionally placed in the circle. He was called, just like the rest of the disciples were called. But he came into the circle with all of his phobias and insecurities and all the things that had grown in him. Don't think just because you make it big, you still aren't small-minded. Yeah, you can be perfectly wealthy and petty. You can be the president and petty. You can make it to the highest office in the land and still tweet because folk don't speak to you. Judas might have made it to the top, but he still had a bottom dweller mentality. Part of it was because if you go and study, he was detached from the rest of the disciples. Well, go. Can I break it down basic? He was the only one of the disciples that was not from the northern part of the nation. He was from the south. You know how we do. Come on now, don't act new on us. You know folk from a certain part of the country think they better than other folk. That's why they get on the radio and talk about Bammers. And y'all foolish enough to be laughing at the Bama of the week. I just don't understand. Why is Bama in? Y'all know who I'm talking about. Why is somebody from Alabama allowing that to even go on his radio show in the first place? Because when you get outside the circle, people do think that we kind of backwards down here. No matter what they do. And so there was that dynamic going on between, y'all think that didn't happen with the disciples? They were people too. And so the folks from the north knew things that folk from the north knew. And Judas was the only one from the south. And at the time, From an archaeological and historical standpoint, they've determined that people from the south of the nation thought they were better than people from the north. And so here he is, he already small-minded, and he thinks he's better than the rest of them farmers and fishermen. I'm better than them. And so wouldn't it matter that he decided that the best job for me to do, I'm not just a disciple, I'm the official bookkeeper. He got to have a title. He's got to have the money. And so that's what they said he did. He, this man, kept the money. But look, Ms. Ruby, look, understand this. He had a problem. I think he had what I call the Dolly Parton syndrome.
I think that's just my little two cents. See, you ever heard Dolly Parton's story? You ever notice that whenever Dolly Parton is on TV, she's always gussied up. Always dressed to the nines. And she said because when she was young, she was dirt poor. And she was going to let everybody know as soon as she made it, that she made it. And so she always dressed like she made it. I think that was Judas. You know, he probably had to have some Kenny Cole sandals when they were walking, you know. Yeah. Yeah, he probably did. You know, his satchel was probably a toomey. He had to have the best of the best. I can't just be walking around with no sheath on, you know. I got to have me a Joseph Abu sheath walking with y'all. He wasn't just gonna play around with it. My belt is Fendi. I mean, he knew what he was doing. He had the Dolly Parton syndrome, and I don't trust any of you ignorant folk to keep the money. I'll keep the money. Y'all can go out and do the little work, but I'll keep the books. He was arrogant, he was uppity, and they didn't trust him. So can you imagine the dialogue between them when they got together? They probably talked, oh, no, don't think people weren't people. This is the same Peter that cussed folk out. If you don't think Peter called him something, look at him over there. They weren't always Christians. They were becoming Christians. And so when you're becoming Christians, y'all always look at these disciples like they got halos over them. No, some of them were just hellions. And Jesus had to love the hell out of them just like us. Yeah. Works in progress. And before they were works in progress, he was the main object of cracking in the group. They probably called him P-head or something like that. I mean, they talked about him. And he developed a problem. Jesus had not supported what he thought the movement was all about. He thought, here we are in the big city, and the boss won't even buy no good shoes. Come on now. Put it into your stream of thinking. Jesus don't even want us to have no headquarters. Surely we need to have somewhere we can operate from. We need to have status. And Jesus was letting them down when he said, my kingdom is not of this world. Judas probably said, what? How you gonna take on Rome and your kingdom is not of this world? I don't understand that otherworldliness, because he was thinking natural and not spiritual. I think he was the first terrorist of the church. I think he was the first terrorist of the church. In fact, like most terrorists we're finding today, we don't have to worry about putting walls up. We don't have to worry about folk coming in illegally. Most of them have been invited into our midst. Most of them are homegrown terrorists. And just like in this circle, this small circle, Judas was a homegrown terrorist. The facts are that Judas kept a low profile, and his low profile and the fact that they wouldn't talk to him often, the fact that they were not trusting of him, or they didn't trust him, and he didn't trust them. The fact that all these things came into play allowed him to camouflage his hypocrisy. Camouflage the fact that he didn't believe or trust what was being taught to them. They didn't ask him no questions when they were having Bible study because they didn't care what he thought. And because they didn't care what he thought, he could simmer and brew and be mad and get madder because they treated him that way. Isn't that what a terrorist does? Though he's in the group, he's not of the group. And he designs how he might get rid of the leaders. And that's exactly what he did. He worked himself into a position apparently of trust with Jesus. And the reason is because Jesus knew him. Can I tell you that? While you're doing all you're doing, Jesus knows what you're doing. And sometimes you just get enough space because you always have the ability to choose. He's not going to choose for you. The Bible says that Judas, this is the terminology according to John is writing this, so look at this from John's vantage point, 12 and 6. It says that John bare what was put therein. That's the treasury. That meant he used to stick his hand in the pot every now and then. Well, you know, they didn't know he had his Visa card attached to the account so that he could get his own stuff delivered every now and then. They knew every now and then a camel would pull up and drop a box off. They didn't know what he was ordering up at the treasury. Yeah, this was for real Amazon.com coming back then. Yeah, he was ordering his own stuff. Yeah, I'm not eating that fig there. I'm getting me some chocolate-covered figs delivered. Because he was in charge of the accounts. Not only did he have a messed up personality, you need to know he had privileges. Oh, he had privileges now. Look, he was called. So no matter what you think of him, he still wore the badge of disciple. You couldn't stop him. He was a disciple. He may not have been a favorite disciple, but when they counted the 12, he had to answer in there. He was one of them. He was called, and he was chosen by Christ. And Christ don't make no mistakes. Maybe Christ called him because he thought, I'll get him close to me, and this will change his heart. I'll let him see me doing what I do. Look now, when they fed the 4,000, he was there. When they fed the 5,000, he was there. When Jesus was performing all the miracles, Judas was there. He saw it all. And yet he saw it and didn't come to the same conclusions that everybody else came to. Look at this. There are scripture, Old Testament scripture, that refer to the personality of Judas. If you look in Psalm 41, Psalm 55, you'll read these words. Let me read Psalm 41 and 9 first. It says, yea, mine own familiar friend, in whom I trusted, which did eat of my bread, hath lifted up his heel against me. Psalm 55, 12 through 14 reads, for it was not an enemy that reproached me, then I could have borne it. Neither was it he that hated me that did magnify himself against me. Then I could have hid myself from him. But it was thou, a man mine equal, my guide, mine acquaintance. We took sweet counsel together and walked unto the house of God in company. Now it seems like Judas is being talked about here, but in truth, treachery didn't start with Jesus and his disciples. This is actually David talking. And David is talking about a man named Ahithophel, who was one of his counselors, who got in league with his son Absalom and tried to overthrow the throne. David had a Judas in his cycle, in his circle, and he wrote about it, but doesn't it frame and fit perfectly with what Judas has done? Can I tell you something? David and Jesus weren't the only ones to have treacherous folk in their circle. You better be careful who you let in your circle of friends, because you might have a Judas or a Ahithophel in your circle too. They'll betray you for their own purposes. Yeah, he was called, invited in. They had lunch together. They went over plans together. He came just like the other disciples. He was consecrated. Hear me now. Just like the other disciples, they ordained. Jesus laid hands on him and said, you one of mine. Just like the other disciples. He was connected to Jesus. Just like the other disciples. Judas was chosen. He was commissioned. He was confirmed. Can you hear me? Am I making this plain? He was not in the circle by accident. He was given the commission, just like the other 11, to go ye therefore and preach. In Mark chapter 11, if I'm not mistaken, Jesus Christ gave them, empowered them to go out and heal and teach folk. That's Mark 11. Something happened between Mark 11 and Mark 14. Because the same Judas who was empowered to teach is now turning on Jesus Christ. And that's why I say he was betrayed by a preacher. I can tell you right now, don't worry about the deacons. It ain't got to be nobody, none of the other officers in the church. Preachers got to worry about preachers. That's what it says right here. He was commissioned. He thought money was power. He equated money with power. Look at this. You won't ever hear anybody else say this, but Judas was disappointed in Christ. The only reason you get upset with folk is because they don't meet your expectations. That's why you get upset with folk. But the question is, what are your expectations? Judas's expectations were worldly. And so if your faith in Christ is that he's going to bring you to a different worldly level, and he doesn't do that, then you're disappointed in him. If you think being a part of a church family is going to bring you instant gratification, and it doesn't happen, then you are disappointed in what Jesus brings. The first discussion in Scripture by Judas tells us his whole personality. The first words, Mason, he speaks about in Scripture is about money. That's his whole purpose. He wanted to know why the money in the bag wasn't used for some greater purpose than for, he wanted to know why the woman was breaking the bottle, the alabaster jar, to wash Jesus' feet. He said, look, we could have taken that and sold it. I know I could have gotten on eBay, and I could have gotten us a good price for that, and y'all gonna break it and wash Jesus' feet? All this conversation told what his personality was all about. According to the other disciples, he was about nothing but this world. And that makes him not the son of Christ, but the son of the enemy. Because the enemy, the devil, is the ruler of this world. And if you put your stock in things of this world, you're not following Christ. You're following the enemy. And so he's condemned. That's what Scripture says. John 6, verses 70 and 71 says that when Jesus called him out at the table that night, when they were having the Lord's Supper, he referred to him by his father's nickname. He called him the devil. He said, he looked at him, according to John, I told you not, John wrote this, and John said he looked at him, a devil. He looked like a saint, but Jesus said he was a devil. Yeah, he was a decent devil. He was dressed to the nines, but he was a devil. Yeah, he acted like the rest of the disciples, but he was a devil. He was a preacher, but he was a devil. He was trusted by some folk in that group, maybe, but he was a devil. Judas was nothing but a wolf in sheep's clothing. He was a devil. And he had a plan. His plan was go to them and tell them. They didn't come to him. It's not like they put out a Google ad saying needed someone to betray Christ. No, he volunteered, went to them, found them. And I was ashamed when I looked at what he took. The Bible said he was willing to take 32 pieces of silver. 32 pieces of silver in today's money would have been about $25. Would have been the price of a slave at the time. Now think about the symbolism. He's willing to betray our Savior for the price of a slave. A slave. He's watched this man feed thousands, but he wanted the price of a slave. He's watched this man heal somebody from the dead. I mean, raise somebody from the dead. Heal people. But $25 is all he asked for. It wasn't even a lot of money. But it didn't matter, it was money. And some of us will sell our soul for nothing. For nothing. So now, before I move down to the conclusion of this message, you just heard me talk about what he sold himself for, what's your price? Oh, because the folk will come out and tell you everybody's got a price. Is it power? Will you give up your relationship with the Lord for power? Somebody came and told you, you can be not a man, but the man. And all the stuff that goes with being the man. All the accoutrements. Yeah, you ain't got to go on Rachel's show. You can have your own show. Is that enough? What are you willing to do in order to betray him? How about pleasure? Will you give up? Ain't nobody gonna say nothing. Oh, but guess what? He knows. He knows what you're selling short for. He knows what's important to you. And he knows, you know if you're important to somebody. We know that, don't we? I know when folk important to you, you call them. You talk to them. You do stuff for them. Things they don't ask you to do. But if they're not important to you, you don't come see them. Not unless you have to. Jesus knew what he was about. But can I tell you how good Jesus is? Knowing how deliberately low down Judas was, Jesus still tried to love him back to righteousness. Let me tell you this. Now you need to know that Jesus all along tried to solve the problems that the world had put into Judas. Jesus tried to love him back into a place of righteousness. There are plenty of examples along the way. Even after Jesus knew Judas had betrayed him, he still tried to love him back into righteousness. When they were at the table that night, at the Passover, Jesus leaned over to him and said, "The one who sops with me is the one who's going to betray me." Judas knew that Jesus knew. Judas knew it. And Jesus leaned over to him and said, "That what you going to do? Go ahead and do it quickly." Perfect opportunity for him to turn and say, "Lord, forgive me." Not only that, Jesus also gave him the favored position at the table. It was an honored custom at that time that if the host of the feast took a piece of bread and sopped it in whatever liquor there was and gave it to you, that was an honored position. He didn't do it to John. He didn't do it to Mark. He didn't do it to Matthew. He did it to the one who had a dagger in his back. Scripture says he sopped a sop. Y'all still sopping today. Don't act like y'all don't sop now. Yeah, they might be giving y'all some good bread at them restaurants. You look around each way and then you go sop on in there. Yeah, y'all might be at Brio's. Yeah. But you remember how it was putting that cornbread in them. No, come on now. It might be fancy pot liquor. But it's still pot liquor. Just the same. And y'all ask, can y'all put a little extra sauce on that? After Judas leaves the gathering that night, it's important that you know that it wasn't until he left the room that the Lord's Supper was instituted. Judas was not a part of the group that got the Lord's Supper. That's why it's important for you to know that only true believers are a part of taking the Lord's Supper. Jesus could have done it while Judas was there, but he waited until Judas left for the Lord's Supper, for him to instruct his true believers. It's the ultimate betrayal. Yeah, as if that wasn't enough, as if he hadn't done enough, Judas had to give his Roman folk a signal. He said, "How are we gonna know Jesus when we see him? He's gonna look just like the rest of them." And Judas said, "I'm gonna kiss the one that's Jesus." Can I tell you how much of a betrayal it was and how committed Judas was to his task? When the Roman legion came upon him, the Roman soldiers came upon him, they said, "We're looking for Jesus of Nazareth." Without any pause, Jesus said, "I am Jesus of Nazareth." All suspense is gone. Jesus has identified himself as the one they're looking for. In other words, don't bother these three. I'm the one you're looking for. Judas, knowing that Jesus has identified him, still goes up to him. Even after Jesus has identified himself and kisses him, not just kiss, but makes a show of it. My Lord, and kisses him, committed to the task. So much so that Jesus had to look at him and say, "You're going to betray me with a kiss?" With a kiss? With the ultimate sign of affection? You're going to take it even after I've told them who I am? You got to carry your plan out. It was at that point that Judas's fate was sealed. So committed to evil was he that he couldn't take any sign, any gift from Jesus to get himself straight. So much so that he had to show out. And so they took Jesus, and the story is that they crucified him. That would be something. Jesus was going to be crucified anyway, can I tell you? If Judas hadn't done what he was going to do, Jesus Christ was committed to saving us. Amen. Judas would have simply been an asterisk. I firmly believe that if Judas had decided, "I can't go through with this," then that would have been a footnote in Scripture that says there was one disciple who sought to betray him. But Jesus loved him enough that he begged his forgiveness. I also firmly believe that the same Jesus who once resurrected, who asked for Peter, who also betrayed him, to come to him, I believe he would have said, "Go tell the disciples and Peter and Judas to come see me." But Judas didn't do that. No, Judas stuck to his guns. He stayed with the plan all the way. And when he found out that Jesus had been taken and crucified, when he found out that Jesus was, in fact, who he thought, who he said he was, the burden was too much for him. The Bible says that he couldn't carry it. Dwayne, the Bible says that he went and he hanged himself. Said he couldn't touch that money. I can tell you, you can work for some all your life. You can give away all that's valuable. You can deal with all the folk who are meaningful in a way that they mean nothing. And you finally get the ultimate prize, and it means nothing to you. Don't take my word for it. Let's go to Hollywood. Let's look at some of them folk who worked all their lives to get to the top. They can't sleep at night. They can find no peace. Who would have thought that Michael Jackson would have been unable to sleep? Come on, you gotta have the best pillows. You can't be the bed. Gotta have the best pillow. Somebody can come in and fan you all night if you want them to. They can make the environment, but see, it's not what's on the outside that keep you from sleeping. It's what's on the inside that'll tear you up every time. And I got news for you. You can come to church Sunday after Sunday. If you don't get what's wrong on the inside right, you're not gonna be able to sleep. Judas never got it right. There's a side story that says that when the priest found out that the money they had taken was blood, they had given, became blood money, that Judas killed himself instead of taking their money. The Bible says that they took that money and they bought a field. And they were going to use that field to bury indigent people, poor folk in. They call it Potter's Field. That's the history of Potter's Field in our community. And so Judas may have had a good thing come out of a bad thing, but unfortunately for Judas, I don't have any doubt that he was damned. It's sad to say that Judas didn't ask for forgiveness soon enough. But what about you? You still have time. You still have the opportunity to get it right. You don't have to stay on the pathway of negativity. You can ask the Lord to forgive you right now. As long as there's breath in you, you can ask the Lord to forgive you. He'll do it. He's begging. He's desperate for you to be his. He's longing for you. searching for you. Acts 1 and 25 says that when Judas died, he went to his own place. Lord, help me. I don't want to go to my own place. I want to go to his place. I want to go to his house. I want to stay with him. The songwriter made it better than I ever could. Judas couldn't say these words. Oh, I want to see him. Look upon his face. There to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. I love it. Cares all past. Home at last. Ever. Everybody say ever. Ever to rejoice. He's got a place that he's preparing for me. Ain't got no mortgage. Don't have to cut the grass. Got to worry about those cobwebs around the house. Still got to keep it clean. I believe that, but it's for me. I don't care if it's a tent or a tower. I just want him to give me something. People always talk about I want a mansion in heaven. I just want a place. It don't have to be no mansion. No, it don't have to be no mansion. I just want a place. Judas messed it up. But I'm desperate for him. I'm willing to forsake all this junk on this side. There's treachery around here. I know about betrayal, but I'm desperate for him. And my question to you today is, do you know him? Do you even know him? Have you given your life to him? Have you shown him that you love him? He went to Calvary for you. He stayed on the cross for you. He died. Don't let anybody tell you he got down early. He died for you. But I'm so glad that that wasn't the end of the story. The Bible says that third day, Sunday morning, he got up. He got up. That's what we say. He got up. Jesus was resurrected. The Lord stuck his hand down into that grave and put life back into it because the debt had been paid. And all he asks is that we believe on that sacrifice. Do you know him? Do you know him? Because he knows you. While the choir sings this song, I'm extending an invitation to you. Come to him. Come to him. Don't stay away from him. He loves you. He loves you. Yeah. He'll save. He has saved. He has saved.
Comes Jesus.
Don't be like Jesus. You can change.
Well, there it is. I hope you were blessed by the God's word. It's my prayer that you will grow from this message. But in case you need a refresher, you can always stop by our physical location and worship with us at 7600 Division Avenue over in the Eastlake community. I believe one visit and you'll find out that we truly are the friendliest church from the parking lot to the pulpit. Looking forward to meeting you. God bless you. Take care.